Sorry about the weather. Thanks for coming, everybody. Thanks to the Morton Library for having us. This is Peter Dugan on guitar. I'm Norm Magnuson. There's Mrs. Dugan right there. And these are, I was going to get rid of all the stuff in my house that I didn't need because I got so much stuff. And I thought, well, instead of just a regular yard sale, I'll make up stories. It's sort of a fictional provenance for these items, thus increasing their value. And I'll make some money that way. And so all the stories you're about to hear are just fiction. They're all made up. This is the first one. Yard sale item number one, shiny black thing. If it ain't true, it ought to be, the kid in the jungle gym said to me as I walked by. At first I was puzzled as to why he was saying this to me, but then I saw that he was, in fact, talking to a couple of other kids who, like him, were also on the jungle gym, hanging upside down and sideways and laughing and alternately talking too loud or whispering in hushed conspiratorial tones. It was one of those disjointed comments that just kind of stuck in my head. Things that I hear and don't quite understand, or do understand but don't quite internalize or whatever. Example, I read one time in an art book these words, purely repetitive and therefore structural. What? Purely repetitive and therefore structural. The phrase stuck in my head for years, and eventually I kind of thought maybe I understood it. But this phrase, if it ain't true, it ought to be. This short phrase uttered by some pot-smoking teenager too old for the monkey bars and too young for the local bars didn't just stick in my craw, it really kind of found its way into my soul. It buried its head deep in the very fiber of my being and has informed nearly all of my creativity since that day so many years ago when I first heard it. It's a fine marching song for artists of any ilk, I reckon, to proffer plausible versions of reality, to imagine the best or the worst, the brightest or darkest, past or future, and to hold it out for others to see as they do, to excel at empathy, itself a creative act, the imagination taking another's place to create a fictional connection that will move or motivate viewers and readers and listeners towards increased understanding, at least, and dare I dream big, action. Maybe even action in the service of making this world a better place. And if that's not a right and noble goal for art, I don't know what is. But I digress. Later on that hot summer day so many years ago, after passing that wake and bake brigade on my way to work, I saw that kid again, gliding down Hudson Street, his backpack swaying loosely on one shoulder as he ate Chinese food out of one of those white cardboard cartons with chopsticks and a certain insouciant attitude. Top of the world, a beautifully engaged teenage ennui, seeing this harsh, unjust world clearly and completely, and caring not a bit anyway. But maybe I was projecting? I don't know. So he's approaching me, walking south, as I'm walking north, heading home, after a long day of work, writing TV ads for Burger King or Count Chocula. And I see him, and all at once, I'm excited. I must have been like 40 at the time, an executive at a big multinational advertising agency. And here's this 15-year-old park rat. And my first thought was something like, oh, wow, there he is. He's so cool. And then, get this, I'm thinking, I hope he recognizes me. But he doesn't, of course. Just keeps on walking, and just as he's about to pass me, this thing flies out of his backpack and lands at my feet. And I pick it up and call him, hey! And he turns around, the look on his face suggesting that he expected some kind of stupid grown-up rebuke for his long hair or unkempt clothes or any one of a million things that stupid grown-ups probably habitually found objectionable about him and felt they had the duty to point out. And I pick up the little box and I say, you dropped this! Well, he doesn't even break his stride. He certainly doesn't break the rhythm of shoveling his mooshu pork or whatever it was into his mouth. And he turns his head back around facing south while he says, no, I didn't. And he was so cool and so certain of himself and his place in this world and just, well, everything, that for a moment I thought maybe he was right. And I stood there, scratching the quick-forming scab off of the laceration that had just appeared in the perceptual sure-footedness that normally informed the daily dance of my life. And as I did, he just kept right on sauntering down Hudson Street, He was half a block away before I came back to myself, back to my senses, or rather the trust therein. Yes, you did, I said softly to now no one there. Well, I opened the box, of course, expecting it to be filled with contraband, and one corner of it appeared to have been nibbled by a mouse or a rat or a ferret or something. And I imagined some little critter getting super high, and it seemed both comedic and tragic, and then I imagined using that scenario in a TV ad for something, some product, but I didn't know who it would work for. And it really didn't matter, because inside this little box was not a big bag of weed or pills or whatever, but rather a shiny black pine cone. Such a strange object. What will they think of next? Well, I closed the box back up and noticed the writing I'd missed before. Graphite object. Oh, so it's a pine cone pencil. Kind of cool, kind of weird. Well, I took it home. When I got there, I pulled it out of my backpack and found a decent piece of good paper, and I took it out for a test drive. I wrote a sentence on it, the first and last thought I ever used it to commemorate. I'm sure you've guessed by now what that sentence was. If it ain't true, it ought to be. Graphite object, $22, including the note. Not sure why, that just seemed like the right number. Plus shipping and handling, of course. The next object is this painting of the dog here. Can everybody see that? All right, good. Yard sale item number 2, pet portrait, $45 plus shipping and handling. Once upon a time in Las Vegas, USA, there lived a woman named Mrs. Frank Sinatra II. Not Junior, but the second. It was a fun name to have, mostly, but also kind of a cross to bear, since she bore no relation whatsoever to the famous Sinatra, neither did her husband, who, though much older than her, was still quite vital. The husband had come to America with the last batch of immigrants who'd entered through Ellis Island. He spoke no English and had a mostly unpronounceable surname, Zento Georgica. The immigration officer he saw that day, having either a sense of humor or a mean streak, we will never know, gave Mr. Francis Zento Georgica the new Americanized name of Frank Sinatra II. And that's what it stayed. Frankie, that's what everyone at the restaurant called him, was a hard worker, semi-retired by the time he and the missus hit Vegas, who could not quite get the hang of not working. In New York City, he had been the head waiter at the Waldorf Astoria, where numerous times he would run into the actual Frank Sinatra, who always gave him a big hug, and except for that one time, which we won't go into, always gave him a big tip for taking him to his table. Sinatra, the singer, not the head waiter, lived there back in the day at the Waldorf in what the old-time staff called the Cole Porter Suite after an earlier tenant. Anyhow, Mrs. Frank Sinatra II had long entertained thoughts of retiring to Vegas with her hard-working man. and fantasized about the two of them playing golf and playing the slots and finding like-minded retiree couples with whom they could play canasta and shuffleboard and dine together afterwards at a good early bird buffet a few nights a week. What she did not entertain was the thought that her husband would want to spend all of his free time working part-time at the Sands Hotel and Casino. Even when not working, he would hang out there and kibitz the other staff and drive them all crazy. Which was a shame, because Mrs. Frank Sinatra II was never driven crazy by her husband. In fact, she loved him thoroughly and with an uncritical heart. One day, their daughter, who now lived in Montclair, New Jersey, and showed no signs whatsoever of ever bringing a grandchild into the family, convinced Mrs. Frank Sinatra II to get a dog, which she did. The dog was named Connie, and though Frank Sinatra II could somehow never remember its name, he mostly tolerated the dog and sometimes even seemed to like it. Anyway, one day, Mr. Frank Sinatra II died while drinking a perfect Manhattan and eating a bacon-wrapped water chestnut at the main bar at the Sands Hotel and Casino. The dish was on their bar menu, where it was billed as a bacon rumaki. The funeral for Mr. Frank Sinatra II was a small affair. Their daughter had flown in from New Jersey, and a smattering of waitstaff from the Sands Hotel and Casino showed up, too. After the funeral, there was a small reception at the house, and Mrs. Frank Sinatra II served bacon rumaki and perfect Manhattans. Some thought it was in poor taste, despite tasting good. And one guest remembered that old star-kissed tuna commercial with a dapper fish named Charlie. And others thought it was a loving tribute and that people shouldn't be so judgy. Perpetrator of poor taste or not, Mrs. Frank Sinatra II got a small insurance settlement, which, apart from commissioning a well-known local artist to paint a portrait of her beloved dog, Connie, she invested well. When she passed, her daughter was shocked to inherit such a large sum of money and used a whole bunch of it to fund the first ever LGBTQ center at the local college where she worked as a registrar under her father's original name, Santa Georgica. She also inherited this painting, which she donated to the LGBTQ Center's live auction one year, which is where my ex bought it for me and gave it to me as a gift just to piss me off. Yard sale item number 3, Victorian boot match holders. When I was 6, I lived outside of Wilmington, Delaware with my family and my big sister, my dog named Happy, and my best friend Louis Matriciano, who lived two doors down just on the other side of Kiki Thompson, Miss Thompson, who was, according to my parents, an entertainer. A stripper, I suspect, in retrospect, but at that point in my young life, she was quite simply the most beautiful and exotic woman I'd ever seen. Still, to this day, no one lives up to my exalted memory of her radiant sublimeness. During the day, I rarely saw her. She slept, I guess, but occasionally, the odd, dusky twilight of a sultry summer eve would gift me glimpses of her leaving her house, getting into her car, a brand new 1966 Mustang convertible that was almost the same color as my favorite Crayola crayon, cornflower blue, and driving away to her work, I supposed at the time, as an entertainer, whatever that might mean. And oh my God, in those moments, with the heat of the day being consumed by the coming coolness of night, she was the most alluring human being I'd ever imagined, with her big bouffant hairdo and colorful makeup and tight-fitting evening gowns that remind me now of that thing that was said by that writer guy about some woman or another, Jane Mansfield or maybe Sophia Loren, when he snarked that it looked like she'd been poured into that dress and forgot to say when. Miss Thompson's whole mesmerizing mystique really wasn't hurt at all by the fact that whenever my parents spoke about her, they whispered. I gathered that there was something about her that Mom found objectionable, but that even more than any perceived character flaws that my dear mother might have attributed to this flawless being, mostly my mom clearly didn't like the fact that my dad clearly did like Miss Thompson. But neither of them, Mom nor Dad, knew my all-consuming secret, that I was actually in love with Miss Thompson. Like, in love, like all caps kind of love. Like pretending to be playing in the sandbox with my matchbox cars, but actually fantasizing about driving off into the endless dunes of the desert with a radiant Kiki kind of love. I thought about her morning, noon, and night, and one evening after dinner, when Mom and Dad were speaking in the hushed tones they reserved for neighborhood gossip about Miss Thompson, I hid around the corner in the dining room and listened to what they were dishing up in the kitchen. I was perfectly silent in my eavesdropping, right up until the point where I wasn't. And I started bawling uncontrollably, sobbing semi-hysterically the moment I heard my mother cheerfully whisper the news to my dad that Kiki was moving away. Naturally, my parents came running, wanting to know what all the ruckus was about, and while I doubt very seriously that that had been the first time I'd lied to them, it was most certainly the most egregious. I'd had to think on my feet quickly, and the story I invented on the spot to hide my juvenile infatuation with Kiki was a doozy of confusing stupidity that was, I guess, just ridiculous enough to satisfy the concerns and curiosity of these parents of this particular peculiar boy. What I told them is that earlier in that day, when I was in the bathroom, I'd dropped my britches to sit down and do a number two and found a big spider hanging out on my little wee-wee, and that I had, just at that moment, many hours later, suddenly broken down over the hours earlier arachnid trespass and transgression in some kind of cumulative, time-released attack of the heebie-jeebies. See? Ridiculous, right? But they bought it. And so the next morning, when a loud roundness of a fellow who was sort of a cross between Lurch and Mr. Clean, but had a pronounced Russian accent just like Boris in the old Bullwinkle cartoon, when this brute arrived to yell at Miss Thompson and to collect her belongings, well, my folks had no idea why I was standing barefoot in my plaid pajamas out on our front sidewalk, surveying the scene and shaking like a short chihuahua in a deep snow. But that mean ogre helping Kiki, he did. He looked right at me and right through me and kind of laughed a derisive laugh that cut straight to my bone. And then he turned to Miss Thompson and said, not yelled, in the loudest speaking voice I'd ever heard, "Ha! This little boy is in love with you." And then, pushing the knife in a little deeper, asked her while looking straight at me, "Kiki, do you love him too?" Oh, delighted at his cruel witticism, he bellowed a big belly laugh that trailed off quickly as if he had suddenly, inexplicably forgotten what he was laughing at. Now, I was plenty embarrassed, of course, but also, I believe, a little bit proud. And somehow, for reasons I still don't quite understand, almost right away, I stopped my shaking. Well, Miss Thompson seemed to ignore this Neanderthal's stupidly spot-on insight and didn't answer him. But then, in a complete power dynamic reversal, she firmly ordered him to pop open the trunk of his big caddy where he'd been stashing stuff that wouldn't fit into her sporty Mustang. Well, the goon grumbled his way to the rear of the car and popped the key in the trunk, and Kiki dove right in, right into a big green duffel bag with the name Thompson stenciled on the side. Mr. Rude Russian was staring at her butt and making some kind of noise as she popped right back up, holding something in her hand. She gave him an exasperated glance as if to shame him for displaying his predictable prurience in front of a kid, me, but he was unfazed. If looks could kill, as the saying goes, he would have had nothing more than a small abrasion requiring one or two of those tiny round band-aids that were constantly adorning my young knees and knuckles. Now, we'd never spoken, Miss Thompson and I. We'd never even been introduced properly. But that bright, chilly morning, she kind of skipped right across the short strip of lawn that separated her place from mine as if we'd been having tea and crumpets in her parlor every afternoon for years. And she looked me straight in the eyes and said, "Thank you, Normie." And then she handed me these two little boots. And then she kissed me on top of my head. And before my feet could once again be reunited with the humdrum, hard gravity of Earth, she hopped into her car and followed the mean guy's caddy right out of our cul-de-sac forever. Over the years, I've invented a bunch of stories about these boots. I used to make shit up about them on the spot if anyone asked, sort of a creativity exercise. Some of the stories were pretty ridiculous, but honestly, none of them were ever as good as the real story, which I've never ever told until just now. Turns out they're actually cast iron match holders made in the shape of Victorian boots. Kind of pricey, but really, how can you put a price tag on letting go of childhood fantasies? $40 for the pair, plus shipping and handling, of course. Yard sale item number 5, Root Bear Stand Vintage Salt and Pepper Shakers, $6 plus shipping and handling. When I was a kid, we used to visit our relatives every chance we had. No matter where we lived at the time, we'd pile in the car and drive out to see them in places like Fort Wayne, Indiana, and Mendota, Illinois. There were also relatives in Chicago and Omaha and every single one of the Quad Cities. We spent a lot of time in various cars and station wagons, staring out the window at cornfields and eventually vast expanses of soy. There were little signs advertising Burma Shave shave cream all over the place, and we delighted in putting together their rhymes as they unfolded, one line on one little sign every quarter mile or so. Here's one quatrain I can still recite from memory. A peach looks good, with lots of fuzz, but man's no peach and never was. And the fifth sign always said Burma shave. We also made a point to stop every time we were out at a root beer stand. They were all over the Midwest, and they had the best root beer and ice cream and other stuff. For some strange reason, I always got the fried clam strips in a toasted and buttered top split hot dog bun. It was called a clam bear, and that's how it went at each and every root beer stand. Non-stop bear puns. The burger, of course, was called the bear-ger. And though I love burgers, I never got it because the clam bear was just so danged yummy. Even better than the famed Howard Johnson's clam boat. Anyway, I brought this recollection up to my big sister last year at a Passover Seder. She converted. And she had no idea what I was talking about. She said we sometimes stopped at A&W root beer stands, which I also recall, or at Howard Johnson's. But she had zero recollection of the root beer stands we must have stopped at over 100 times. I wondered about her mind going. She's 3 years older than I am. But I also reckoned that maybe a glimpse at their logo would help jog her memory. The logo was the shape of a bear made out of root beer bubbles rising up out of an orangish glass mug. The orange ochre shade was their color, all the interiors, the glasses, the menu, everything. So I pulled out my phone and typed in root beer stand to show her the logo and make her remember. But all I got was, do you mean root beer stand? No fucking Google, that's not what I mean. I mean root beer stand, that's why I typed that in. Well, I looked again and again, but not a thing. Now my big sister started in right away, laughing and calling me crazy and looking at me with those mock caring, mock sympathetic eyes that have always bugged the crap out of me. Well, I looked again when I got home to my big computer and nothing, zero, zip, zilch, nada. I even asked my friend who has like a backdoor key to the internet or something and can find everything with her fancy search technique, but she didn't find anything either. Then I remembered that I still had a souvenir salt and pepper shakers from a root beer stand that we used to stop at in Mendota, Illinois. I took a picture of them and sent it to my sis. Still no dice getting her to remember. But now, just a little note of actual concern in her voice, which was even more annoying than the earlier mock concern that was expressly meant to be annoying. Anyway, here they are, a salt and pepper shaker from the famous root beer stand chain, I guess it was a franchise, which once dotted the American Midwest in the 60s and 70s. A trusted and delightful stop on our frequent family road trips, and one that really and truly once existed. I'm not just imagining it, even if all other record of it is completely gone. Thank you. yard sale item number 6, porcelain cocks. $7 each, plus shipping and handling, sold as a pair. Nobody wants to think about their parents having sex, but sometimes it just can't be helped. This is a story about that, kinda. A little background. My friend is really one of the most creative people you'd ever want to know. I'd tell you her name, but she's a rock star and will probably appreciate my discretion. Let's just call her Jane for the purposes of this little ditty. Unlike many creative people, Jane seemed to have had a fairly idyllic childhood, loving parents and a nice youth in suburban Miami. She even got along with her brother. Let's call him Dick. Her dad sold used office furniture or something from a place supposedly out near the airport and was what you'd call a pillar of the community. Rotary Club, vice president of the Chamber of Commerce, and assistant coach of all his kids' sports teams. Jane even had a picture of her dad posing with the rookie Dolphins quarterback Dan Marino. Neither Dick nor Jane played football, but Jane was a soccer star. She even claims to have played against a young Mia Hamm at a tournament in Wichita Falls, Texas. I Googled it. Mia Hamm did indeed play soccer in Wichita Falls, but I'm not sure the dates line up with Jane's story. Anyway, Jane's dad died when she was in her 20s, and Jane's mom lived on for another few decades, spending the entire time, according to Jane, buying crap. Jane even wrote a song about it by that name. It's hilarious and sad and paints a poignant picture of drowning the sorrow of loss in the joy of acquisition. One of the lyrics is something about her mom holding her grief in an antique colander. Always loved that image, kind of like how they describe a football team that allows a lot of successful running yards as having a Swiss cheese defense. So where were we? Oh yeah, Jane's mom, background. First, a story about Jane's Dick, her brother Dick. When they were kids, Jane's big brother Dick explained the bases to Jane. You know, first base is kissing. Second base is copping a feel over or under the bra. Third base is touching someone down there. One of my favorite euphemistic descriptors. And fourth base? Well, Jane's Dick told her that fourth base is when you do the first three bases all at the same time. Jane says she immediately thought, I don't know if I'm coordinated enough to go all the way. I'm guessing she's become more coordinated as she got older since she currently has 5 kids. Anyway, when Jane's mom became a widow, in addition to acquiring crap, she also became more family focused and a little bit of an oversharer, according to Jane. And at dinner, she would always have a glass of wine, and the wine would always go straight to her head, and she would always let slip some suggestive comment about her porcelain cocks. Jane says that she and Dick would always cringe a bit, but manage a tiny courtesy chuckle and change the subject as soon as possible. They never had any idea what their mom was talking about until after she died. Okay, now I'm really done with the background. Just as I'm planning on doing, Jane's mom left a household full of crap for her kids to sort through after she died. And here's the crazy creative part. Jane came up with the idea of sending all of her mother's crap piece by piece to everybody they knew. So she and Dick sat down with their address books and just kind of randomly packaged up tchotchkes and curios and bric-a-brac and whatnot, and without any explanation, sent it off to friends and acquaintances. They actually took it all down to one of those pack-and-ship places that packs it all up for you for an extra fee and then ships it off. They began in the dining room, plates, gravy boats, crystal salt cellars, and so on, and worked their way through the kitchen and living room and into the bedrooms, doing their mom's room last. And there in the drawer of the bedside table on their mother's side of the bed, where she still slept even after having had the entire bed to herself for decades, were these two ceramic roosters, laying on a nice lace doily as if they were fine china. As Jane tells it, she pulled them out and held them up for her brother, Dick, to see. She claims she looked quizzically at him, but that his jaw dropped immediately. "Oh my God," he reportedly screamed, followed with an even louder exclamation, "Porcelain cocks!" Well, Jane dropped them both immediately, connecting the dots the way anyone really would. But somehow they didn't break. I always imagined a cream-colored wall-to-wall short pile shag carpet on the floor of that bedroom with the top-of-the-line carpet padding underneath. Okay, now I'm really done with the background, which, of course, I didn't know any of, when out of the blue, one day, I got a little yellow slip in my post office box, and I picked up a package with the return address of a pack-and-ship place in Miami. I really didn't even know anyone in Miami. Years later, Jane came to visit. She had a gig at the famous Bearsville Theater in Woodstock and stayed at my place out on Mink Hollow Road, a road made famous by an album called The Hermit of Mink Hollow, which is by Todd Rundgren, who just happened to have produced Jane's first record album, right up the street, Small World. Well, her first night there, Jane saw the black rooster sitting on the mantle above the fireplace and started laughing so hard that I was afraid for her breathing and or her sanity. Eventually, I was only afraid for one of those things, and she told me the story that I have attempted to faithfully report here above. Black roosters, porcelain cocks, or any permutations of those two adjectives and those two nouns you'd like, washed and Windexed and sent your way from the local pack and ship place in Rhinebeck, New York. Enjoy. So good. I don't always know what he's going to play, so it's just delightful to hear these choices. Yard sale item number 11, mystery object. Teeny Tiny Tammy was my best friend all through high school. She was amazing. Everyone always thought we were boyfriend-girlfriend, but we never even considered it. We were too much like brother and sister for any of those kinds of shenanigans. Anyway, right after we graduated in 1978, Teeny Tiny Tammy took off. We both hated our hometown, and she left as soon as she had that high school degree in her back pocket. No college, no job, no prospects. She just skedaddled right on out of town. Now, this was the age before the internet and Facebook and cell phones and whatnot, and so, as it happened, when she left town, she disappeared. And my heart ached horribly. I wondered about her over the years and wondered if maybe I did something wrong or said something stupid to drive her away. I would call her old house once in a while and ask her parents if they'd heard from her, but they never did either. One day I called and the phone had been disconnected. Later on, I heard from the neighbors that they'd moved south somewhere, taking with them all my hopes of ever seeing teeny tiny Tammy again. In retrospect, I think maybe that's why I stayed in Keokuk all those years. Not because it was the county seat or right on the Mississippi River or because it's the southernmost city in Iowa, but because I didn't want to miss my friend if she came back. I missed her enough already. One day, shy of my 50th birthday, my mom called. I assumed she was calling to wish me an early birthday, but no, a letter had come to the old house and the new owners had brought it to her. It was for me, from Tammy. I still get teary-eyed just remembering the tornado of emotions that filled my being when Mom told me this. She said she'd bring it over to me the next day along with my traditional coconut birthday cake, but I couldn't wait and I left work right away and tore over to Mom's condo. The envelope was in one of those baggies that the post office puts damaged mail in. My heart sank when I saw it, but the letter inside seemed unharmed. I tore it open. I still recognized her handwriting. Tammy didn't say too much in it, just that she thought of me nearly every minute of every day, and that she was really sorry she hadn't written or called sooner. I didn't even know I was crying until a tear landed on the baby blue writing paper. The return address was Carson City, Nevada. I found her building right away when I arrived there, a four-story apartment complex in a decent-seeming part of town, but I had no idea which apartment was hers. So I stood by the mailboxes with the 1978 Keokuk High School yearbook I'd brought. I kind of held it open in front of me whenever I heard footsteps approaching so as to not appear too threatening and maybe to pique interest instead of fear. A couple of people gave blank stares. If they knew her, they didn't let on. I guess I wouldn't have talked to me either. Snitches get stitches, as they say. And then I heard her footsteps. I heard her footsteps coming. I knew it was her right away. It's funny the way people have different ways of walking, different unique gaits. It was her, and I knew it, and I just froze. I just froze standing under a fucking freak with that yearbook opened up to her senior photo. Her standing in the sun, leaning up against a tree in her cap and gown. I knew it was her, and she walked around the corner, and I was right. I was right about everything. I was right about her. I was right to drive 24 hours to get here. I was right that it would be wonderful to see her again. And I was right that I would burst into tears, and I was right that she would smack me upside the head in that strange token of love and appreciation that had defined our youthful friendship. Well, we sat on the floor of her apartment and talked for 100 hours. I glowed and glowed and caught some naps, and every time I woke up, she seemed to be watching over me and glowing herself. We'd known each other for 4 short years and had not known each other for over 30. It didn't matter. We were home, and it just felt so great to be there. By and by, I had to get back to Iowa. I didn't want to, but I had to. Tammy and I had lived those 30 missing years together in a few days, and now I could get back to life. Maybe even leave Keokuk, maybe go east. On my way out, she ran to the kitchen and came back and gave me this bizarre object. I wondered out loud if maybe it was something she'd used in her earlier life working at the Bunny Ranch Bordello. Oh my God, the stories she had. But she swore that it was not, that it was just some strange thing she'd picked up at a yard sale in the free box because it reminded her of an octopus, her favorite animal. She said I should hold on to it until my new life began and then, quote, sell it to a kind soul for a good price. We laughed, I left, and that's the last time I saw teeny tiny Tammy. Maybe she'll come visit me in New York City someday before another 30 years goes by. Price, $1,580. That's what teeny tiny Tammy got on her SATs. I still remember. Just one tiny smidge away from perfection. Bouncer, please throw this woman out. Come on, Sandy. So many hecklers today. Yard sale item number 22, Indian Chief ashtray. My friend was a shrink, now she's a millionaire. She created a wildly successful practice helping people with problems that they were too embarrassed to discuss with their usual shrinks. She said the problems were wide-ranging, but most often had to do with addictions that were supposed to have stopped. Drugs, pornography, sex, romance, profligate spending, whatever. But in fact had not stopped. And her clients wanted sort of a kind of extracurricular therapy to help them deal with those two issues. First, the addiction or whatever it was. And secondly, the issue of not being truthful with their regular therapist, which she felt more often than not indicated a much deeper problem dwelling within the hearts and minds and souls of these temporary patients of hers. She had a strict rule that she would not speak with her clients any more than 3 sessions total, after which she sent them packing back to their now cuckolded regular shrinks. For the privilege of cheating on their therapist with her, she charged $400 an hour. And this was back around the turn of the millennium. So that's like $3,200 a day, $12,800 a week, $640,000 a year. Her own spending was anything but profligate, and amongst us who knew her well enough to pull her pigtails about it, downright cheap. But as excessively frugal as she was fiscally, she was at least as generous in matters of donating her time. And on Wednesdays, she volunteered at a woman's shelter doing her thing, talk therapy, with the women who were housed there. Every Wednesday for decades, she could be found talking with these women who had been battered or bruised or forgotten or fired or just somehow otherwise taken advantage of by society or culture or a significant other. Once in a while, would be walking to dinner or a play or whatever, and one of these women would recognize her and rush up and hug her and invariably start crying as they thanked her for her ear and her insight. I remember clear as can be one particular night going to see a big Broadway production. I think it was Jerome Robbins's Broadway, which was great. And this tattered old woman with long chin hairs came rushing up towards us. I was kind of terrified, of course, but my friend held open her arms and called, "Cindy!" And within a second, they were hugging and chit-chatting. And shortly after that, Cindy, who looked as if she really hadn't even finished first grade, laid down one of my favorite quotations from Hamlet. "Beggar that I am even poor in thanks." And she skedaddled right away back across the street to her small cabal of other grizzled street people. My friend told me that before her life-changing psychotic break, Cindy had been a professor of literature at Columbia and was A, fucking brilliant, B, the sweetest human being she'd ever met, and C, even crazier than she was sweet or smart. I told my friend how wonderful I thought it was that she continued to help these people out for free, and she stopped me in my tracks with loud shh. She was completely incapable of letting a misunderstanding, misstatement, or unfact have a life out in the conversational world of more than just a millisecond. She corrected me right there in the front of the Imperial Theater in 45th Street, where we were just about to sit in seats that must have cost like $800 a pop, that all of her women's shelter clients, in fact, did pay her. Well, my world tumbled almost as fast as my esteem for her, and she continued, "I never accept money, but I insist on payment with something else, anything else. It helps them to value my time and my insights. If you give it away for free, people don't value it as much." Well, while I was mulling this over, she fished around in her big bag and soon enough pulled out this ashtray. "Cindy gave me this today," she said, and held it out for me to take. I did and looked it over. I went to pass it back to her, but she waved me off and asked me to accept it in the spirit with which it had been given to her. And now, dear listener, I want to give it to you as an appreciation for hearing my story and to let you know that I value your time and your insights. Thank you. Indian Chief Ashtray, made in Japan, my gift to you, plus shipping and handling, of course. Thank you. ¶¶ So good. And now comes the part of the show where you all choose one last object to hear the story of. So feel free to get up and browse around, talk amongst yourselves, pick one object, and I'll read that story. Yard sale item number 4, whisper lanterns. $24 plus shipping and handling. Like lots of people's grandmas, my maternal grandma was a little bit magic. Sure, most of the time it seemed it was going to be the I'm turning you noisy, nosy, impertinent self into a toad kind of magic, but what with her grizzled, gnarled, arthritic fingers and all her kind of witchy name. Her name was Agnes. But there were exactly 2 memorable times where it was the other kind, the good kind, white magic, I think they call it. The first time, Grandpa was cutting down a tree. He'd already made a big cut sideways V into the side of it so it would fall away from the house. And he was cutting through to that V from the other side when all of a sudden the tree decided that it was going to fall off of its stump and pin Grandpa to the ground. I saw it, so did my big sister. And then, just as fast as it happened, it unhappened. Almost as if someone had hit the rewind button on the VCR. The tree was still on its stump. Grandpa finished sawing, and it just fell away from the house as originally planned. Happy ending. Inexplicable happy ending. We watched the tree fall. We ran to Grandpa and hugged him and jumped up and down and asked him what had happened. And he had no idea what we were talking about. Then we stared at Grandma with shock and fear and gratitude and confusion and about a dozen other feelings. She had to have seen what had happened. We'd all been watching together. She had to. But nothing in her countenance betrayed that she had. As my mom used to say, butter wouldn't have melted in her mouth. She was that cool. We stared at her for a second too long, and she just kind of nodded towards the kitchen and told us to run inside and get Grandpa a glass of water. Not too cold, she added as we ran off indoors. The second time was when she gave us these here whisper lanterns. Light a candle and lift up the glass and whisper your dreams inside, she instructed. And eventually your dreams will come true. Of course, I broke the glass on one side of mine right away, so now you kind of have to yell your dreams into it. But it still worked fine anyway, right up until my last birthday. Grandma had said to pass them on when we turned 60, and my big sister gave me hers when she did, so I had 2 of them for a spell. But for the past year, they really haven't worked at all. Now I'm 62 and finally doing as Grandma had told me to do. So light a candle and whisper in one, or kind of yell in the other, your deepest desires. They might not come true right away, but they will eventually. Pass them on when you hit 60.
I didn't know which one everybody was going to pick, so this is where I get to sort of wing it.
Yeah, on the spot, baby.
Yeah, so.
Thank you. So good.